We want to welcome you to another edition of God's Living Word, a program brought to you by First Presbyterian Church of Greenville, Ohio. First Presbyterian is located in historic downtown Greenville at 114 East 4th Street. We can be reached by phone at 937-548-3188. We hope as a result of this service that you will find that our message is uplifting and meaningful to help you in your daily walk in spiritual life as a Christian. Throughout the week, we have several ministries that I know will be of help to you. Wednesdays in particular, there are several Bible studies for both adults as well as children. Our Logos ministry is for children preschool through fifth grade. We have JAM, Jesus and Me, for junior highs, and then our senior high ministry Wednesday evening. If you do not have a church home, we invite you to participate and be involved in our worshiping community, whether on the airwaves or certainly personally in the congregation. At this time, we'd like to invite you to be part of our family of faith here at First Presbyterian as we worship the Lord and listen to God's living word.
Let's continue our worship with our songs. The first one is, I Sing the Mighty Power of God. This is an old one. You'll like it.
Sing the mighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad and built the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to rule the day. The moon shines full at God's command, and all the stars obey. I sing the goodness of the Lord that fills the earth with food. God formed the creatures with a word, and then pronounced them good. Lord, how thy wonders are displayed wherever I turn my eyes. If I survey the ground I tread or gaze upon the skies, there's not a plant or flower below but makes thy glories known. And clouds arise and tempests blow by order from thy throne. While all that borrows light from thee is ever in thy care, and everywhere that we can be, thou God art present.
Jehovah, Lord God Almighty, the balm of Gilead, the rock of ages. He is Jehovah, the God that healeth thee. Sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah. He is Jehovah, Lord God Almighty, he is Jehovah, the God that healeth thee. He is the great I Am, the God of Abraham, Jehovah Shalom, the God of peace I am, the God of Israel, the everlasting one. He is Jehovah, the God that healeth thee. Sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah. He is Jehovah, Lord God Almighty.
Jehovah, the God that healeth thee. He's your provider, Jehovah Jireh, God of salvation, God of Messiah. The Son he sent to you, he testified of him. He is Jehovah, the God that healeth thee. Sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah. He is Jehovah, Lord God Almighty. He is Jehovah, the God that healeth thee. He is Jehovah, the God that healeth thee. He is Jehovah, the God that healeth thee.
Oh, good one.
I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. But sometimes I wonder what he can do through me. No great success he shows, no glory on my own. Yet in my weakness he is there to let me know.
Have a prayer of confession. Dear Lord, we confess to you that we are sinners and need you to help us get through our days with a love in our hearts to help others and to be your ambassadors to the living word. Our mistakes are many, but we know that through you we are forgiven. Amen. Now the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence you shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Good morning to everybody. Okay, two of you sit down there. Today I want to talk to you about a Bible verse, something that God said in Matthew 5, verse 14. God say, we are the light of the world. What do you think that means? That means, yeah, God is good. God wants us to be good. Anything else? Jack? No. Okay. Well, I think God wants us to shine, to be beautiful, and to be nice to other people. Now, if you think of something shining, we think of a flashlight, don't we? Okay, and this one doesn't want to shine. I wonder why. Let's see what's going on inside. Oh, shoo. What is inside? What is this? A dirty rock. It's yucky. Okay, that's why the flashlight doesn't want to shine. So if we put back, maybe we put batteries in there. Shining. Okay. Now, maybe our lives, the sin in our lives, the stuff we do wrong can be like a dirty rug. And we have to try to get that out of our bodies. So we have to ask God to forgive our sins. Okay, let's pray. Dear God, please remove all the dirty rugs from our lives. And help us to shine for you. Amen.
Now comes the announcements. We want to welcome all who are here for the first time, and there are blue plastic bags in both our north exits, the front and the side. If you're interested to know more about what our church is about, grab one of those bags. And even if you've been here for a while and you want to know what our church is about, grab a bag. We want to welcome today Pastor John McCurdy. He is the retired United Brethren pastor from Pennsylvania and has 23 years of ministerial experience. We always want to welcome his wife, Claire, who's sitting there, and their daughter, Christy. Okay, there. I missed it by that much. So they're here to watch their husband and dad do a wonderful job. I know he will. At the end of each pew is the friendship register, so sign it, pass it down, bring it back so you know who's in your pew. Confirmation class starts next week at 9:30. Children from 12 to 14 are encouraged to attend. The church will have a bowling party on Sunday, March 19th, at McBowes Lane's in Versailles. The cost to bowl two games and rent shoes is $8, with pizza and soft drink following bowling is $4. So sign up is in the side narthex. Now, this Wednesday, we are having our Lent dinner. And so far, we've only had two people signed up, and we really need to know. If you're coming, please sign this insert, put it in the giving boxes at the doors as you leave today. We really need to know how many are planning to attend so we can plan the meet. So please sign up. The next one is the pink Lent luncheon that is going to be held at the Lutheran Church starting this Wednesday at 12 o'clock, and it has a list of the ministers who are going to be preaching, and there will be a soup and sandwich luncheon at 12:30, so it should be, go in, listen to what they have to say, have a nice lunch, and visit with people. After our meal on Wednesday, we're having the Lenten service in here at 7 o'clock. I have a few favorite services. Christmas Eve, of course, is the best one. But this one has so much meaning, and to be able to reaffirm your faith in God, to know that He is there to forgive your sins. This is such an uplifting time. So we encourage you, even if you cannot come to the dinner, please come at 7 o'clock for the service. I need to say a special appreciation to Dale Fryman. He has done such a bang-up job for his mom. You know, I don't know what we would do without you, Daryl, and I hope they double your pay, whatever it is. After church, we're having refreshments in the social hall, and the flowers are doing it, and I'm sure they're going to be wonderful. So please come, every one and all. It'll be a great time. Okay, let us now bow our heads in prayer. Dear Lord, we come to you with thankful hearts and minds. We give you praise for all you do in our lives. Thank you for filling our hearts and minds with your presence. Be with all the ministers of your word, whether they are in the U.S. or on foreign soil. They give up so much to do your work by leaving their family and friends and go places we've never heard of, but you give them the strength to carry on your work. Please be with those whose health is not good. We think of Jim Fryman, who is back in the hospital with pulmonary problems, Paulette Shields, who needs your strength to get through her days, and Tony and Charlene Walters, whose problems are many. There are so many others that have personal, financial, and health problems, and some people are just plain lonely. Let each and every one look up to you to help them get through their difficult journeys. Please show our elected officials the path you want them to follow. It's a difficult job that needs your guidance in honesty, love, and understanding. Be with our church and our leaders as we go forward toward you, and help us bring as many people along with us as possible. Let the Holy Spirit come down on all of us. We ask all of this in the name of Jesus Christ as we continue to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Lily Hayes will be coming up and reading our New Testament scripture lesson, John 3:19-24. And after she's read the scripture, Don Lockhart's going to be coming up and doing some special music.
Hear the word of the Lord, 1 John 3, verses 19 through 24. And by this we will know that we are from the truth and will reassure our hearts before him. Whatever our hearts condemn us, for God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything. Beloved, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have boldness before God, and we receive for him whatever we ask before, because we obey his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we should believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he has commanded us. All who obey his commandments abide in him, and he abides in them. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit that he has given us. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. Tuesday mornings, we have a great group of guys that get together for breakfast and a Bible study. And I like those guys to stand right now. You can see who some of them are. That's you, Leroy, Bill, and him. The last several months, almost a year, we've been reading this Max Lucado book. It's all about burden. The burden of self-reliance, weariness, worry, hopelessness, guilt. Well, you get the picture. And our Sunday school lesson this morning for our Sunday school group even touched on some of these things. But as I look around the congregation, I know that our own congregants have had to deal with burden. Fire, auto accidents and injury, health concerns and doctor's tests, and to the point of even separation by death. So this song is just an assurance that we have a loving God that cares for us. Hold it all together, everybody needs you strong. But life hits you out of nowhere and barely leaves you holding on. And when you're tired of fighting, chained by your control, there's freedom in surrender. Lay it down and let it go. So when you're on your knees and answers seem so far away, you're not alone, stop holding on and just be held. Your world's not falling apart, it's falling into place. I'm on the throne, stop holding on and just be held. Just be held. Just be held. If your eyes are on the storm, you wonder if I love you still. But if your eyes are on the cross, you know I always have and I always will. And not a tear is wasted. In time you'll understand. I'm painting beauty with the ashes. Your life is in my hands. So when you're on your knees and answers seem so far away, you're not alone, stop holding on and just be held. Your world's not falling apart, it's falling into place. I'm on the throne, stop holding on and just be held. Just be held. Just be held. Lift your hands, lift your eyes. In the storm is where you'll find me. And where you are, I'll hold your heart. I'll hold your heart. Come to me, find your rest. In the arms of the God that won't let go. So when you're on your knees and answers seem so far away, you're not alone, stop holding on and just be held. Your world's not falling apart, it's falling into place. I'm on the throne, stop holding on and just be held. Just be held. Just be held. Just be held.
I'm hoping my mascara is not running, because that brought tears. That was a wonderful, wonderful piece of music. Ah, again, John McCurdy, thank you. Our scripture and our sermon. Thank you.
We're reading this morning from Romans chapter 8. In your pew Bible, it's on page 157. I'll be reading from the New International Version, but you can follow along with yours. Shall we stand for the reading of God's Word? Romans 8, 1 through 11. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do, because it was weakened by the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in the flesh, in order that the righteous requirements of the law might be fully met in us, who do not live according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Those who live according to the flesh have their minds set on what the flesh desires, but those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but are in the realm of the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of his Spirit who lives in you. May God add his blessing to the reading of those powerful words this morning. You may please be seated. Well, I'm not a walker like Pastor John is, and I'm not a singer like Pastor Doug is. I'm just a preacher, a substitute this morning. A minister was telling the congregation that he was a substitute, and a young man said, "Well, what does that mean?" He said, "Well, you know what a substitute is, when you break a pane of glass in your house, and then you put a piece of cardboard over it, and tape it up until you can replace that." And then the young man understood. Afterwards, he said to the preacher, he said, "Preacher, you're not a cardboard. You're a real pain." And no doubt some of you may say that about me this morning. Let's go back to Romans 8. This passage of scripture and this message is one that I want to deliver to Christians. There were questions in my mind for so many years about exactly what this passage of scripture meant. And I don't say I fully understand it now. I feel I have a handle on it now. Now it makes sense to me. First, let's consider that there are three kinds of people. You may have heard that there were only two, the saved and the unsaved. But there are really three. There's the unsaved, and then there's the carnal Christian and the spiritual Christian. The carnal person is a person who has received Christ as his or her Savior, but is still controlled by the sinful nature or sinful flesh. The King James Version uses the word carnal. The NIV translates it worldly. Paul wrote about carnal or worldly Christians in 1 Corinthians 3, 1 through 3. "Brothers, I could not address you as spiritual, but as worldly, mere infants in Christ. I gave you milk, not solid food, for you were not yet ready for it. Indeed, you are still not ready. You are still worldly. For since there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not worldly? Are you not acting like mere men? So here were people whom Paul addressed as believers. They were Christians, yet he said they were still worldly, acting like mere men, not those whom the Spirit has control. If we want to find an example of a worldly person, I think we can see a good one in the Old Testament prophet Balaam. Now, Balaam was not an Israelite, not of the chosen people of God, but he did have some kind of relationship with the God of Israel. He received visions from God, and he prayed, and God answered him. He was a prophet. Yet his heart was not set on pleasing God, but pleasing the enemies of God's people. Balaam was so stubborn that God gave his donkey the gift of speech to rebuke that wayward prophet. And this fascinating drama concerning Balaam is found in the book of Numbers, chapters 22 through 25. But that's not the last reference to Balaam. And he is spoken of in the New Testament, even in the book of Revelation. And he's never referenced in a positive way. For Balaam eventually did cause much sin to enter into the camp of Israel. The way of Balaam is a way of selfishness, worldliness, and carnality. Though he knew God, he certainly wasn't living the way he should. And when we think of people doing what they know they ought not to do, we think of Romans chapter 7. And this is a little lengthy portion of scripture, but I want to read that to you as well. Romans chapter 7, starting with verse 15, which talks about not doing what you really want to do. And I think I have lost my place. Here we go. Romans 7, 15. I do not understand what I do, for what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. And if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. As it is no longer I myself who do it, but it is sin living in me. For I know that good itself does not dwell in me, that is in my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do, this I keep on doing. Now, if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is sin living in me that does it. So I find this law at work. Although I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For in my inner being, I delight in God's law, but I see another law at work in me, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within me. What a wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? Thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then I myself in my mind am a slave to God's law, but in my sinful nature a slave to the law of sin. Now we know that Paul wrote the book of Romans, so no doubt he is giving us a personal testimony here. What kind of testimony is it? He says he is not able to control his actions. He wanted to do what is right, but he ended up doing what he knew was wrong. What a very sad commentary on a Christian's life. Now wait, think about it. What state was Paul in when he experienced that kind of existence? It certainly could describe an unregenerate or unsaved individual, couldn't it? Not being able to keep the law, having pangs of guilt for breaking it, this could also describe the carnal Christian. He is having trouble doing what is right because he is led by his sinful nature and not the Spirit of Christ. I've heard some refer to this passage of the Bible as a proof text to show that no matter how hard we try, we can never, even as believers, do what is right. That's unfortunate because Paul would never agree to that position. He did say that he was helpless to change himself, and that's just the point. We cannot change ourselves. We must be changed by the Spirit of Christ. We cannot obtain victory through our own efforts. We must have the one who gained victory over sin and death to procure it for us. This scripture, then, is not a description of the normal life of the Christian. I wish people would stop getting that mixed up. We cannot justify our shortcomings and sins by referring to this passage. Paul was writing to illustrate the need of something better. Paul was either referring to his life when he was an ardent Pharisee and persecutor of the Christian church, or when he knew Christ but was not yet controlled by the Spirit. He was not a spiritual Christian when he lived like that. This is evident by the first part of Romans 7:25 that says, "Thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord." See, he didn't leave us in Romans chapter 7 doing the things we don't want to do, but he said there is deliverance through Jesus Christ. If there was no hope of a better life, if there was no hope of deliverance, he would not have written that. Now we go on to Romans 8. Just as we have seen that there are three kinds of people, the unsaved, the carnal Christian, and the spiritual Christian, now we consider that there are two, even three types of condemnation. I had always thought that there was just one condemnation. It was a death sentence. It was being condemned to hell for eternity. It was being in a state of unbelief. Note what Jesus said to Nicodemus. He told this religious Pharisee, this seeker after truth, that even though he was a good man, he must be born again. In John 3:18, Jesus said, "Whoever believes in him is not condemned. But whoever does not believe stands condemned already because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son." The Amplified Bible really does bring out this concept of condemnation here. Listen to what Jesus said with comments from the Amplified Bible. "He who believes in him, who clings to, trusts in, relies on him, is not judged. He who trusts in him never comes up for judgment. For him, there is no rejection, no condemnation. He incurs no damnation. But he who does not believe, cleave to, rely on, trust in him, is judged already. He has already been convicted and has already received his sentence because he has not believed in and trusted in the name of the only begotten Son of God. He is condemned for refusing to let his trust rest in Christ's name." Well, those are pretty strong words. And they were said to a man who was a Pharisee, a religious leader, a ruler of the highest Jewish council of the day. Nicodemus was, as far as we know, a good man. But Jesus set him straight. Your goodness, your own righteousness, your keeping of the law, your being a decent person will not make you fit for God's kingdom. You must believe on Jesus Christ. You must allow him to bring you to God. Turn from your own efforts to Jesus. He's the only way to God and heaven. Now, if that was said to such a good person, what does it mean to someone who knows he is a sinner? If a good, decent man cannot please God by his goodness, a sinner should not think that if he tries to be better, that he'll make an impression on God. If a good person does not impress God with his goodness, then there's no point in the guilt-ridden trying to come to God by endeavoring to turn over a new leaf and to act right. We all come to God on the same basis, and that is trusting in Jesus Christ. When we do, we are free from condemnation. Your final destination, then, is heaven, not hell. Your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. You are saved. I heard the testimony of a minister who told how his life was before he came to Christ. Well, his family did go to church, yet he was heavily involved in drugs. He was a bad dude. And then he came to Jesus, and Christ forgave him, and his life immediately changed. Yet his mother was concerned for his soul because he didn't go to their church anymore. She pleaded with him to see the pastor. He did, but he would not go back to that church. Later, this convert's mother asked her pastor about her son. What will happen to my son if he doesn't come back to church? And the pastor said, he's going to go to hell. And the mother responded, not now. Now he is good. Before, yes, but not now. She could see that her son was no longer under condemnation. He had passed from death to life. Well, usually when a person comes to Christ, there's a dramatic change, and then they grow in Christ. Sometimes the growth is slow, as in the case of the Corinthians, whom Paul said were still babies in Christ. Sometimes people backslide and enter into a sinful lifestyle again. It can be gradual or it can be sudden. We see in Romans chapter 7 that some who are saved are living as if they are not. This brings me to the second concept of condemnation. It has to do with the life that we now live in Christ. Romans 8:1 reads, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. What kind of condemnation was he talking about in Romans chapter 7? That was being condemned to live an ungodly life. Jesus does not just save us from hell, he also saves us to live a godly life. We're not condemned to live like an unbeliever in this sinful world. We do not have to be carnal or worldly. There is deliverance. There was a man I knew who attended a church that I went to as a teenager, and his life still impresses me today when I think back at him. And it's a long time since I've been a teenager. He did not do anything really spectacular. He was not a good speaker. He wasn't that pleasing to look at physically in manner or dress. What I remember is that he was once an alcoholic, but he came to Jesus and never drank again. Jesus delivered him from the lifestyle that he could not control. He was no longer condemned to be enslaved to sinful habits. He was not condemned to hell any longer, and he was not condemned to a hellish existence any longer. Go to Romans 8:2 now. Through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. The reason I know this is deliverance from Romans chapter 7, where the man is always doing what he does not want to do and not doing what he does want to do, is because Romans 7:23 calls it the law of sin. Therefore, the Spirit has set you free from the law of sin and death. Do not stay in Romans 7 when you can be set free in Romans 8. Do not use Romans 7 as an excuse to live like the world and indulge in the sinful nature, because God gave us Romans 8. The Spirit, God's Holy Spirit, who gives life, sets you free from sin, from carnality, from worldliness. God's plan for you is not to live in Romans chapter 7, but to live in Romans chapter 8. He does not desire for you to be a carnal Christian, but a spiritual Christian. He wants you to be led by the Spirit, not by the flesh. He wants you to live in victory, not in defeat. He wants you to be a shining example of his grace, not to live a life of shame. Well, there are Christians who are ashamed of the way they live. Temptation is all around us. Our electronics bring it right into our homes, too. There are Christian young men who have become addicted to pornography. They just can't seem to kick the habit, and it's drawing them farther and farther away from their faith. It is destroying them from within. There is help if they seek it. It may take some Christian counseling, but that's why God has given us people with that talent. To get aid, the worldly have to get so fed up with their life of guilt that they want to change. That's how it is for those who are carnal. There is help for the carnal Christian, but they have to want it and come to Christ to receive it. You do not have to be condemned to live that life. The Spirit is waiting to set you free. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. What terrific news that is. Let us be people who are set free to follow the Spirit. Let us be those who are not condemned to live in sin any longer. Now consider another form of condemnation, and this is self-condemnation. We can be forgiven and have no sentence hanging over our head, but still be locked in a prison that we cannot get out of because of guilt. The conscience is a good thing, but it can become our undoing. Think of those words which Lily read to us this morning that talk about if our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart, and he knows everything. Sometimes our heart condemns us when we've already been forgiven of those things, but we somehow still feel that we're locked into that prison. Now, let me recap now before I give you a final story, which is for the birds. There are three kinds of people: the unsaved, the carnal Christian, and a spiritual Christian. And there are three kinds of condemnation: a sentence to final destiny, life in bondage to sin, and prison in our own mind. The Holy Spirit will set us free to live by the Spirit so that we can fulfill the purpose for which God has created us. Now, this closing episode is an excerpt from a former zookeeper, Gary Richmond's book. It's called It's a Jungle Out There. And why I said it was for the birds is because it's about birds. Oh, there it is. It didn't make sense to me. The criminals were as free as a bird, and the birds were in jail. It probably won't make sense to you either. Let me explain. When I was first transferred to the zoo health center, I found myself caring for a cage full of red-tailed hawks. There were 15 of them, and they were crowded together in a pitifully small cage. To my eye, they looked very depressed. I asked why we were caring for 15 red-tailed hawks off exhibit, and the answer really frosted me. The senior keeper, an extremely jovial Mexican-American man by the name of Johnny Torres, said, "Each of these hawks are evident for court trials. Some people caught them illegally, and we keep them here until their trial is over." "What happens when the court trials are over?" I asked. "I don't know," he answered. "We never hear. Some of these birds have been here a long time. We don't even know which bird goes with which trial. So they'll probably die here." "That doesn't make sense to me," I protested. "Richmond, did someone lie to you and tell you things make sense around here?" "It's best not to ask too many questions about this either. The guys down below, down in the administration, they don't like to know that they got problems. So my advice is to drop it." Well, it just wasn't in my nature to drop it. After all, this was injustice, pure and simple. The poachers were free and the poachees were being punished. I inquired around gently and in time became convinced that the birds were in trouble. Nobody cared about their plight, and the red tape to get them released was so sticky that no one could wade through it. There was really only one answer. They had to be set free. But it's hard to look, it had to look like an accident. A punishment for letting out low-risk animals with nothing more than a notice to correct a deficiency. I had never received one before, but I figured it would be a small price to pay to right this wrong. I decided that I would let the birds go on a Tuesday afternoon when the supervisors were at the Animal Health Committee meeting. They would be gone from the area for about 2 hours, more than enough time to accomplish my mission. Tuesday came and the supervisors left the hospital area. I made my way out to the cage, slipped the lock out of the hasp, and left the door wide open. I looked around, there was no one in sight. I slipped back into the health center and set about my duties with a profound sense of fulfillment, an abiding feeling of satisfaction. It was not to last. After 1 hour, I decided to check the cage. Astonishment, disbelief, wonder, and confusion reigned supreme as I beheld all 15 hawks relaxing in the cage. There was still time to get them out. Perhaps they just needed some inspiration. Well, I knew what would inspire them. I ran into their cage, waving my arms and growling like a bear. That inspired them, all right. They flew out of the cage and landed not 10 feet from the door. The look that they gave me was pitiful. They were confused, and it was clear to me that they wanted back into the cage. "Don't you see the sky?" I pleaded. "That's what you were meant for." I began feeling a little self-conscious inside the cage, so I stepped out to finish my address. "What's wrong with you? You're not chickens. You're majestic birds of prey. You hunt your food. God gave you a purpose. Now go fulfill it." I decided to go back to the health center. Maybe their instincts would take over and they would feel some primal urge to command the wind. I left for 15 minutes and then returned. Not one bird had left or felt any urges. In fact, some had walked back into the cage. With 15 minutes left to go, I gave up. I don't mind telling you, I was more than a little deflated. I rounded up the birds like a herd of goats and put them back into the cage. Where had I gone wrong? I had approached their problem anthropomorphically, which is a fancy way of saying I was projecting my thoughts into the minds of the birds. The birds had not been sitting in the cages longing to be free. Those were my thoughts. They had long since become satisfied with just waiting to be fed. No famines to suffer, no droughts to survive, no territorial battles to enjoin. It wasn't all bad. I felt bad, but they didn't. The reason I felt bad was because by caging them, we had taken something away from them that they needed to be noble, their purpose. God had created the red-tailed hawks to hunt rodents and reptiles. Few birds can equal their elegant flight or fearless pursuit of prey. This group of birds had been robbed of their ecological purpose. And what's more, we weren't even letting the zoo patrons appreciate them. That bothered me. I thought a bit more about freedom as I finished my responsibilities that day. I concluded that freedom was the ability to fulfill the purpose for which you were created. I further reasoned that man had an interesting distinction. Unlike the animals, he can never be kept from fulfilling his purpose. He is always, in every circumstance, free to perform the function for which he was created. Man's purpose is to love and serve God. The more difficult the circumstances, the greater the opportunity to achieve that purpose. We are now and will always be free to be what we were meant to be, that creature designed to glorify God and enjoy him forever. Are you fulfilling the purpose for which you were created? Or have you become satisfied with the ways of the world? You have the freedom to choose. And we know that there is freedom and victory in Jesus. Let the Spirit of Jesus Christ be our guide and set us free to be what God wants us to be today. We pray in his name. Amen.
Thank you, John. We want to dedicate our gifts to God. The offering boxes are at the entrances at the back of the church. As you're putting your offerings in, don't forget your reservations for Wednesday if you're planning to come. Lord Jesus, you are rich, yet for our sake you became poor, so that through your poverty, we might become rich. Accept this collection and offering as a token of our gratitude for all you have done. Amen. Our closing hymn is Victory in Jesus. We need a praise team up here. This is an old hymn that I wasn't really sure about, but it doesn't take long. I think most of you know it.
Oh, Savior came from glory. How he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning, and I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see.
Him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen.
We hope you've enjoyed another edition of God's Living Word, a program brought to you by First Presbyterian Church in downtown Greenville. If you're looking for a church home, we would love to invite you to come to our Sunday School Hour, which begins Sundays at 9:30, with morning worship to follow at 10:30. We're located in historic downtown Greenville at 114 East 4th Street. We can be reached at 937-548-3188. And if you're looking on the web, we're at www.greenvillepres.org. Throughout the week, we've got several ministries, small groups, Bible studies, along with youth and children's ministries on Wednesday afternoon and into the evening. There's something for everyone. And we do hope that you might consider First Presbyterian. We would love to have you part of our worshiping community, whether it be in person or on our telecast Wednesday evenings. But until next time, may God's word dwell richly in your life. Goodbye from First Presbyterian.